Welcome to Dayspring Fellowship. Whether you are in the room live, watching live online, later on demand, or listening to our podcast, thank you for spending time with us today. I can promise you that this will be time well spent, not because of me, but because God is at work in your life and an investment in your spiritual journey is never wasted. I'm Chris Voigt and I lead the team here at Dayspring. Our team loves to challenge, encourage, and equip people just like you to become more like Jesus. And as a result, people grow here. We're committed to helping you grow in your love and devotion to Him too. If this is your first time visiting Dayspring, we want you to know that this is the kind of church where you get to be you. We're just like you, imperfect people on a journey. We're allowing Jesus to make something beautiful out of our broken and often messy lives, learning to live like Him a little more today than yesterday, a little more tomorrow than today. Even if you aren't sure that you're ready to be on that journey at all, maybe you are skeptical about the claims of Jesus or skeptical of His followers. I get it. And this is still a great place, a safe place to explore and ask questions as you look for answers. We're asking those same questions and looking for answers too, so you'll be in good company. You can learn more about us as a church by exploring our website at dsf.church, by checking out our Facebook page, or contacting us by phone or email. If you need help figuring out the next step to making Dayspring your home church, or if you just have questions, let us know. We'll help you find the answers. For today's service, you can find a discussion guide by selecting Watch from the top menu of our website. And now, let's join our service. When you think about you, what age are you? Now wait, before you answer, maybe think about it this way. If you could pick any age to return to, what age would you pick? What is your ideal age? What age were you at the best you? I mean, I know that I'm 56, but most of the time I don't feel 56. I feel more like 36. I kind of see myself as 36. 36 was a good year. I had already been on staff here at Dayspring for a few years. Our marriage was in a great spot. Our kids were out of those early years, which are so hard on parents. I still had more energy than I knew what to do with and attacked life like the Energizer Bunny. And I felt like I was finally figuring out who I was and what God was doing in my life. Now, for the record, I was still recovering, like the rest of the church was, from a nasty church split that had sucked the life out of me. Those hard early parenting years were about to become harder tween teen years. Yes, my marriage was in a great spot, but the lack of money often made the road more than a bit bumpy. And I really had no idea what God was doing in my life. And honestly, I like myself a lot more today than I did then. But even so, when I think of myself, even though I know that I am 56 and older and wiser, in a part of my mind, I'm still 36. That was my heyday, age-wise. I want 56-year-old me in my 36-year-old body. So how about you? How old do you see yourself? So even though I know that I'm 56, I still feel 36 until I look in the mirror. There's a reason they say denial ain't just a river in Egypt. The mirror doesn't lie. When I look in the mirror, I am faced with the stark reality that I really am 56, and unfortunate things are beginning to happen to my body. That's why I know we all thought we were done with campaigns, but that's why I am launching my No More Mirrors campaign. Who needs reality? Ignorance is bliss. I choose ignorance. Can't we just go through life looking at each other through one of those Instagram filters that makes you look like a Disney prince or princess? Although I'd really have to be 36 to figure out how to use it. You know, I think most of us approach our spiritual lives much the same way. We idealize our Christian experience. We like the idea of being more spiritually mature than we really are. So we convince ourselves we are. Even though we know that God isn't a cosmic genie that grants our every wish, we want him to, and we're disappointed when he doesn't. Our Christian culture has cultivated the idea that the more Christian you are, whatever that means, the fewer problems you have, the less suffering you have to go through. The more like Jesus you are, the easier life gets, because God blesses Christians. Even though we know better, we all have this little bit of name it and claim it prosperity gospel in us. We really want it to be true. We want God to keep us healthy, keep our marriages happy, keep our kids from going crazy, keep our bank accounts full with enough money for a new car and a family vacation to someplace fun and exotic every year. We know that's not how it works, but we want it to work that way because we are more committed to our own comfort than we are to becoming like Jesus. We want growth without pain, love without sacrifice, joy without mourning. We want the staples easy button version of becoming like Jesus. But when you look at the pages of Scripture, you read a different story. You see joy in the midst of sorrow, comfort in the midst of loss, strength in weakness, healing in pain, power in humility, beauty in brokenness. When you look at the living and active pages of Scripture, as the author of Hebrews writes, it cuts through all illusions straight to the heart, revealing exactly how unlike Jesus we really are. So you can begin to understand why the church in Corinth had developed a love-hate relationship with the Apostle Paul. He kept inserting himself into their illusion, a constant reminder that God is less committed to your comfort than he is to your character. It created friction between what they wanted to be true and what was actually true. And faced with the truth, they sought refuge from voices who fed and justified their illusion by minimizing the ministry of Paul. Now, if you're joining us for the first time today, we have reached chapter 6 in Paul's second letter to the church in Corinth in a series that we've called Jars of Clay. We've covered way too much territory to summarize it all. But in a nutshell, Paul has spent the first part of this letter reminding the Corinthian believers that choosing to become like Jesus is choosing to walk the way of suffering, because it is through suffering that Jesus heals and redeems our brokenness, bringing wholeness to our body, mind, and spirit. It is through suffering that we learn how to allow the glorious presence of God to shine through our brokenness, bringing light to a world full of darkness. This hard, often painful, unhurried work of the Holy Spirit in us is the only way to become like Jesus. And as Pastor John taught us last week, it's made harder by the longing of our hearts to shed our broken bodies as we exchange them for our eternal ones. We're caught in the in-between of this reality and that reality. It would be so much easier if we could escape to eternity. Then we could avoid our suffering completely. All of our problems would be solved in an instant. Although that's not how we really describe it, we try to be much more spiritual than that. We just long for heaven. Do you really want to arrive in heaven only 13% like Jesus? I mean, let's call it what it is. We are more committed to our comfort than we are committed to becoming like Jesus. So the easy way, the comfortable way, is the way of escape. I've felt that way a kajillion times in my life. No more sickness, no more tears, no broken hearts, no more bills, no more arguments, no more school, no bullies, no deadlines, no more adulting. Amen, hallelujah. The problem with this attitude, of course, is that our new life in Christ comes with divine purpose. Now, if we back up a few verses into chapter 5, our new life in Christ, as Paul writes, is a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ.
And God has given us this task of reconciling people to himself. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sins so that we could be made right with God through Christ. What we have been given is too important to be kept to ourselves. We've been given new life to give new life, to resuscitate dead people. It's spiritual CPR. We are ambassadors of Jesus Christ. And as ambassadors, we speak for the kingdom of God. Therefore, that's my therefore, not Paul's therefore, as we transition into chapter 6, our passage for today, there could be a therefore. Paul is continuing this argument. So therefore, as God's partners, we, that is I, Paul, and the entourage who travels with me, as God's partners, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. For God says, at just the right time, I heard you. On the day of salvation, I helped you. Indeed, the right time is now. Today is the day of salvation. So as we begin chapter 6, Paul is still referring to the final verses of chapter 5. This marvelous gift is the favor of God poured out through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Salvation through Jesus came at the right time. And here in verse 2, Paul is quoting from a prophetic song found in Isaiah chapter 49. In the song, a passage in the Old Testament that Paul's readers would have been familiar enough with to only need these two lines to know what Paul was talking about. In this song, Jesus, although they didn't know it was Jesus at the time, is described as God's servant, sent to help the Jews faithfully live the way God called them to live. This servant would also be a light to the Gentiles so that everyone on earth would know God and trust God to save them. The servant wouldn't use a sword to do his work, but his words would be like a sword. He would be treated badly before being put to death for the sins of God's people. He, who knew no sin, became a sin offering. And this is significant for us. What this suffering servant modeled is that, unlike Job's friends in the Old Testament story of Job, Job's friends thought that people who did foolish and sinful things were made to suffer. This suffering servant suffered when he had done no wrong. But he suffered to help God's people. He modeled that suffering can lead to the salvation of other people, which is right in line with everything Paul said up to this point. When we suffer as Christ followers, there is a deeper purpose on many levels. Suffering makes us more like Jesus, as we've already talked about. And suffering builds a connection with people who do suffer for their foolish and sinful decisions for the purpose of leading them to Jesus. At the right time, when the world was ready, our suffering servant came to save us. In verse 1, Paul calls this the marvelous gift of God's kindness. In the New International Version, it is simply God's grace. And he tells us not to receive it in vain, not to ignore the responsibility that comes with it. As ambassadors of God's kindness, we have been called into the ministry of salvation. So no, Corinth, no, Dayspring, don't expect the life of Riley. Don't think that becoming like Jesus will ever lead you to a comfortable life. If that were the case, as we've just learned, your comfort would come at the cost of someone else's salvation. And that's not okay. God does his best work in less than ideal circumstances. So whether we are in the middle of our own suffering or we enter into other people's suffering, when we get uncomfortable, which is a less than ideal circumstance for us, when we let the law of love lead us, the what does love require of me at this moment kind of love that we talk about frequently, love will lead us to sacrifice our comfort for the benefit of others. We will, as Paul and his merry men do in verse 3, live in such a way that no one will stumble because of us, and no one will find fault with our ministry. Now, if you've read 1 Corinthians, you might remember that Paul has already addressed this issue with the Corinthians when he talked about the eating meat offered to idols. His overall message throughout his New Testament letters is that we are no longer in bondage to either sin or the Old Testament laws. We walk in freedom, not the American kind of freedom that we are most familiar with. That freedom is me-centered. I can do whatever I want, whenever I want. I being the key word. A corrupted view of what even our founding fathers meant. But for Paul, our freedom requires us to, as he says in Galatians 5:13, use our freedom to serve others in love. So, going back to 1 Corinthians, if you're at a dinner party and the host serves you meat offered to idols, you can eat it freely as long as you know that your eating it won't be a stumbling block to anyone else. And if your eating it will be a stumbling block to anyone else, you use your freedom to not eat it. Whether the meat has been offered to idols or not isn't the issue. The spiritual impact on others is the issue. So the bottom line is that we are to live in such a way that we never get in the way of someone coming to salvation in Christ. Any sacrifice, discomfort, or suffering on our part is worth it for the spiritual life of another. Verse 4. This applies to everything we do. There is no on-off switch. It doesn't apply to only when we are on as Christians, but when we are running to the grocery store, waiting in line at the bank, interacting with your kids' teachers, or driving down I-5. There is no off. We are always on as ambassadors of God. We never know what God will use to connect with someone else's life. So verse 4, in everything we do, we show that we are true ministers of God. We patiently endure troubles and hardships and calamities of every kind. We have been beaten, put in prison, faced angry mobs, worked to exhaustion, endured sleepless nights, and gone without food. We prove ourselves by our purity, our understanding, our patience, our kindness, by the Holy Spirit within us, and by our sincere love. We faithfully preach the truth. God's power is working in us. We use the weapons of righteousness in the right hand for attack and the left hand for defense. We serve God, whether people honor us or despise us, whether they slander us or praise us. We are honest, but they call us imposters. We are ignored, even though we are well known. We live close to death, but we are still alive. We have been beaten, but we have not been killed. Our hearts ache, but we always have joy. We are poor, but we give spiritual riches to others. We own nothing, and yet we have everything. I think our American Christianity, though an incredible blessing because we can freely worship as citizens of this great country, but our American Christianity has also corrupted our suffering muscles. You have to use muscles to grow muscles. And the truth of it is that we really don't have to suffer much as American Christians. I mean, when was the last time you were beaten for your faith? Or faced an angry mob for your faith? I'm pretty openly a pastor from a very Christian resistant family. And they've always been pretty respectful of my vocation, even if they don't understand it and think that I'm wasting my time. And for most of them, I don't even know that that's how they feel because they've been so respectful. I've even performed 2 weddings for family members. So I'm just assuming some things. The worst suffering I've suffered for Christ in my non-Christian family is lovingly being referred to as the black sheep of the family by my grandmother. So our suffering muscles never really build any strength, which makes us suffering averse. We go out of our way to avoid suffering for our faith. We don't talk about Jesus in our workplace because we might suffer. We don't invite people to church because we might get uncomfortable. Our aversion to suffering leads us to living safe lives, stuck in ruts, living a me-centered version of Christianity because we never put ourselves in a position where God has to show up or we fail. We use our freedom to serve ourselves. You know what happened when Paul took a risk as he used his freedom to love others? As Eric Mason writes in his commentary, he shut down idolatrous businesses. He freed people from human trafficking. He confronted racism. He shattered legalism and religion. He crushed licentiousness. He unveiled false intellectualism. He preached Jesus as the living God. He was countercultural and transcended culture. Can you honestly tell me that our culture doesn't need a little more of exactly that? Sin hasn't changed in 2,000 years. We need to channel a bit of Paul in our lives. He continues in verse 11. Oh, dear Corinthian friends, we have spoken honestly with you and our hearts are open to you. There is no lack of love on our part, but you have withheld your love from us. I am asking you to respond as if you were my own children. Open your hearts to us. So again, Corinth, Dayspring, don't be taken in by anyone who would lead you away from these truths. Don't be afraid of suffering, but count the cost. It is because I love you and I'm telling you these uncomfortable truths. There is no suffering-free life, even for Christ followers. We will suffer as we become like Jesus. We will suffer when we enter into other sufferings as we love like Jesus. But we don't take God's grace for granted. We don't receive God's grace in vain. Because someday, as we learned from John last week, we will stand before God to account for how we've used our bodies, minds, and spirit for the glory of God. Paul is calling us to take our relationship with Christ seriously. Jesus isn't just part of our life. He is all of our life. We are called to define our lives by the truths found in God's word. They should inform every thought and every action. I talk to people all the time who want to experience the power of Christ moving through them. I talk to people who are stuck in a rut that they can't seem to escape, who want God to show up and do something new in their lives. I talk to people who long for God to give them the desires of their hearts, who want to make a meaningful contribution to the work of God in this world. They want the blessing and favor of God without the sacrifice, without suffering, without discomfort, without risk. Our country is filled with Christians who live this way. Paul doesn't want us to be like that. We have a divine calling to sacrifice everything, even our lives, for the sake of God's kingdom. So what kind of Christ follower are you going to be? If we want to stand out for Christ, to really shine for his glory in this dark world, we must be different, live differently. We can't blend in for the glory of Christ. Now, for all of that to be true, we have to protect our hearts from the lies that lead us not just to seek comfortable lives, but any lie that could cause us to compromise how we live. So with that in mind, we should keep this in mind. Verse 14, don't team up with those who are unbelievers. How can righteousness be a partner with wickedness? How can light live with darkness? What harmony can there be between Christ and the devil? How can a believer be a partner with an unbeliever? You've probably heard this truth in the context of dating. Anyone? I remember my parents wanting to make sure I dated only Christians. The same with Dee Dee. And we felt the same way with Josh and Lexi. But the meaning is much richer than that. When Paul wrote this, people would plow their fields with bulls or oxen. A team of, let's say, oxen would be yoked together to pull a plow so they could plant seeds in the spring. It would be strange to see different animals yoked together. Like you wouldn't see one ox yoked to a donkey. Not only would the yoke not fit the donkey, but different animals have different strengths and weaknesses. They move at different paces. Yoking different animals together would be a recipe for disaster in your field. Paul is referring to the words of Jesus in Matthew 11. There, beginning in verse 28, Jesus says, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light." Now, in context, Jesus is referring to people who have tried to follow the Old Testament law, but failed. Even with rabbis who tried to help by developing clarifying rules for unclear parts of the law, which were also called a yoke, even with the rabbis' help, failure was inevitable, and people felt the weight of their failure. So Jesus says, "I'm giving you freedom from trying to do it on your own. You can simply yoke with me. I'm not yoking with you, you're yoking with me. You can take off the yoke of the law and take on my yoke. Take off your own effort and let my death, burial, and resurrection do the work for you." So when you yoke with an unbeliever for matters of the soul, you will always put yourself in a yoke that will weigh you down. As Eric Mason points out in his commentary, unbelievers can tell you how to buy a car. They can tell you how to buy a house. They can give you advice about which job to take, but they'll never help you become like Jesus. They'll never help you become a healthy, mature, spiritual adult, and there isn't anything more important than that for our lives. Unbelievers can only give you the wisdom of the world. That's all they have to offer. But we know that God's wisdom is the only wisdom that matters, and it's found in the opposite direction of the world's wisdom. Don't open yourself up to that risk. Satan is really good at dressing up the world's wisdom on the front end, but the back end always leads away from Jesus. So no, don't date unbelievers, because dating leads to marriage most of the time. And once your heart gets involved, it will justify bad decisions. Ask any married person, any married to an unbeliever person, if there isn't something missing in their marriage. They will tell you that there is, and it is almost always one of the greatest sorrows in their lives, even in loving relationships. So to those of you who might already be unequally yoked, be Jesus with skin on to your spouse. Trust God's perfect work in your spouse as you love them to Jesus. Celebrate what you do share together rather than mourning what's missing. And at the same time, never allow their unbelief to sway you from Jesus. And don't allow the lie of shame to keep you silent. You aren't alone. Allow God to redeem your story as you share it in a way that honors your spouse with people who might be headed down the same path. And for the rest of us, also, don't go into business with an unbeliever. When you need counseling, go to a Christian counselor. When you need advice, find a Christian mentor or friend. Don't let matters of the heart be influenced by people who don't share the same priorities of your heart. God, and in this case, Paul, isn't trying to keep you from something or someone. He is protecting you for something or someone. But there is something even more important than you, believe it or not. Verse 16, And what union can there be between God's temple and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God said. Now, notice the we in the we are the temple part in this verse. He doesn't say you are the temple, but we are the temple. In one of the great mysteries of the body of Christ, it is true that each of us is the temple of God. In fact, in his first letter to the Corinthians, Paul put it this way. Don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you and was given to you by God? You do not belong to yourself, for God bought you with a high price, so you must honor God with your body. Now, as a side note, you've got to love the continuity in Paul's writing. He said this in 1 Corinthians, and then last week, John talked about being held accountable for how we use our bodies in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. So the mystery is this. My body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, and each temple is complete. We each have all of God in us. And as the church, capital C, we are the body of Christ. And together, we are the temple of God. And he addresses this truth in 1 Corinthians as well, just a few chapters before the your body is a temple verses, beginning at verses in chapter 6. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, he writes, don't you realize that all of you together are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God lives in you? God will destroy anyone who destroys this temple, for God's temple is holy and you are that temple. Stop deceiving yourselves if you think you are wise by this world's standards. You need to become a fool to be truly wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness to God. As the scriptures say, he traps the wise in the snare of their own cleverness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise. He knows they are worthless. I included verses 18 and 20 because they support Paul's argument that we don't want to risk the corruption of our hearts with the world's wisdom. But like he says in verse 16, back in 2 Corinthians, Paul is referring to our community as Christ followers. We together are in communion with the holy, righteous God of the universe. He does not align himself in any way with the sinful corruption of this world. As a community of Christ followers, we are called to stand apart, to be separate from this world, out of a reverence for the holiness of God. So returning back to verse 16, and what union can there be between God's temple and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God said, and he quotes the prophet Jeremiah here, I will live in them and walk among them. I will be their God and they will be my people. Because of Jesus, God will make his dwelling in us. And then quoting Isaiah in verse 17, therefore, come out from among unbelievers and separate yourselves from them, says the Lord. Don't touch their filthy things, and I will welcome you. So because God has made his dwelling in us, we must no longer fellowship with the world. Paul adds that we are to stay away from the worthless rags the world has to offer, and instead, we witness to it. And then again, from the prophets, he quotes, and I will be your father, and you will be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. So to sum it up, Paul is saying that the more you do life together in community, as you grow together, the more you will realize that you don't belong to the Father of this world, but instead you are surrounded by the constant presence of God Almighty. You are children of God, and we live differently because we are children of another kingdom. We live by its rules. We embrace righteousness. And then rolling into verse 1 of chapter 7 as we close, because we have these promises, dear friends, let us cleanse ourselves from everything that can defile our body or spirit, and let us work toward complete holiness because we fear God. So since all of this is true, get rid of anything in your life that is keeping you from experiencing the presence of God in your life. Keep becoming like Jesus. Now, as we close, even though we've covered a lot of ground today, the bottom line is pretty simple. Does your life reflect these values? Or are there areas of your life that might be stumbling blocks to others? How are you using your freedom in Christ to serve yourself or others? Are you more committed to your comfort than you are to becoming like Jesus? What's the state of your temple? What is your heart telling you that needs to change? Let's pray. Father, in these moments, just in the silence, we ask that you would speak to each one of us. We've all got something that corrupts our temple. We've all got something that we've said yes to that we should have said no to, or we've said no to that we should have said yes to, that keeps us from experiencing the presence of God in the way that we want. Father, we pray that you would speak to our hearts. Reveal the way that we are to walk. You know what is possibly true for someone in this room, someone watching online? It's possible that you've never said yes to Jesus at all. And today, the time is right. Today is the day for you to say yes, for your salvation. You know, following Jesus doesn't fix all of your problems. It just inserts him into those problems as he redeems all of that stuff, all of that junk, and uses it for his glory. If you'd like to say yes to Jesus, it's really easy. You just have to say yes. Jesus came, he died for your sin, and then he rose again 3 days later to give you new life in Christ. All you have to do is say yes, that you believe, that you want to follow Jesus with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength, whatever that looks like. And here in this place, this is a great place to learn what it is, what that looks like. And just say yes. And as a side note, if you do say yes, we'd like to know about it. Just so that we can encourage you and help you take some next steps that will lead you along the path of righteousness. For the rest of us, give us the strength, the boldness, the courage, the whatever we need to step into what you have for us, no matter what it looks like, no matter what that suffering could be or is. The price that Jesus paid is worth anything that we suffer on our part. We could have lives of misery and it would never equal up to one precious drop of his blood. So may we live our lives to honor that, not because we have to, but because we want to. Out of love and devotion, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
thank you for joining us today. Let me encourage you to download the discussion guide by selecting Watch from the top menu of our website. Working through those questions on your own or with others will help the truth of God's Word begin to shape your life as you grow to be like Jesus. Please reach out if you have any questions or want help on your spiritual journey. My email address is on the screen, or you can call the church during the week. If you're just checking us out today, please know that we don't expect you to give anything to support Dayspring. We count it a privilege to play a small part in God's perfect work in you today. The people who call Dayspring their home church make this ministry possible. Their faithful giving is proof of God's work in their lives, and they want to pay it forward so you can experience the same life-changing presence of Jesus. For those of you who would like to start giving, we have three easy ways for you to get us your gift. Please see the online giving section of our website, or text GIVE to the number on your screen, or mail a check to us at the address you'll find on our website. Until we meet again, I am praying that God will give you opportunities to use your influence for the glory of His kingdom. One easy way to do that is to share this service with your friends and family. If this service was a blessing to you, it'll probably be a blessing to someone else too. Thank you for liking, sharing, and following Dayspring on whatever platform you connect with us. Thank you for rating us where that's appropriate. All of these simple acts of kindness on your part, God uses to plant seeds in other people's lives. So keep sowing.